welcome to the Lost Media Chronicles, a show of which goes over various lost music, movies, art, you name it. And today we'll be talking about one of my favorite musicians of all time, of whom some of his tracks have just recently been uncovered and released. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the story of Jeff Buckley. Out of all the various musicians that I'm into, no artist has ever influenced me more than Jeff Buckley. During his lifetime, Buckley gained much critical attention and acclaim, but tragically drowned in 1997 at the age of 30. His music is known for its intense buildups, eclecticism, and amazing vocals. Now, originally, the Jeff Buckley episode was going to be something I covered next year in order to recognize the 20th anniversary of his death. However, recent events have brought him back into the limelight and relevancy, and I'll go over that in detail a little bit later. But right now, let's talk about his career, and I guess you could consider this to be an unofficial episode of Two Beats Plus on Jeff Buckley, because I consider him to be a little bit too sacred to do a full-out review on, because I think it would be too biased, and by biased I mean too positive. So, let's go ahead and get this started. Jeff Buckley was the son of Tim Buckley, a famous jazz and folk singer-songwriter who died young himself at the age of 28 of heroin overdose. Jeff only ever met his father once and spent much of his career trying to brush off his father's shadow. He displayed amazing musical ability throughout his childhood and was expected to follow the same path that Tim did. After high school, Jeff left for a music school where he learned to hone his skills as a guitarist. The earliest available recording of Buckley is from a 1988 demo tape called Babylon Dungeon, which sounds rather rough and underdeveloped compared to Buckley's later work. This demo tape was previously left unreleased to the public until it leaked online sometime in the 2000s. Before this tape leaked, the only evidence anyone had about its existence came from friends and family members, as well as the biography titled Dream Brother: The Lives and Music of Tim and Jeff Buckley. Seeing as this is an early work that was only meant to be passed around to record executives, it seems only natural that not many people had heard it before it leaked online. In the early 1990s, Buckley was living in New York City, struggling to make a living as a musician. His most frequent and beloved early venue was called Chenay, a small Irish-owned coffee house. Known for its claustrophobic space and enchanting atmosphere, Chenay proved to be the perfect venue where Buckley could show off his chops. It allowed his audience to be close to him, and since the venue lacked a stage, it kept him at the ground level, which made him look like he was being one with them. He was known for his various cover songs, many of which would never be performed again after its initial performance. Some of these songs were allegedly recorded by audience members and were passed around in bootlegs. However, very few of them seem to have surfaced online. One of these songs, a cover of the Velvet Underground's All Tomorrow's Parties, did eventually leak onto YouTube. However, it's unknown if this song came from Chenay or from an entirely different performance.
And what costume shall the poor girl wear?
It wasn't long before record executives heard about the young, more talented son of Tim Buckley performing to large crowds at this venue. It started to become a usual sight to see these executives at shows making them offers. Eventually, and infamously begrudgingly, Jeff settled with Columbia, now owned by Sony. Known for being home to many of Jeff's own heroes such as Bob Dylan, it only seemed natural that this was the record company he would go with. For his first release, both Jeff and Sony wanted to capture one of his performances at Chenay, since he was looked at as a heritage artist. They wanted to capture this rare phase in a musician's career where it felt much more intimate than it ever would. Sony recorded two sets of two concerts. The second set was recorded after the first set apparently didn't go so well. This resulted in a Live at Chenay EP released in 1993. The EP only comprised of four tracks. 10 years after its release and almost 6 years after Buckley's death, Sony expanded the EP into a full two-disc set featuring the full second set of concerts, including several monologues performed by Buckley in these performances. This is actually a really nice introduction to get into Jeff Buckley. If you've ever listened to Grace or sketches from My Sweetheart the Drunk and didn't find him your cup of tea, actually give this one a shot. You get a really good sense of who he is as a person, and it helps you understand his music a lot more. Listeners can find themselves captivated by the man's ability and eclecticism. Best parts, however, are the monologues, which are absolutely hilarious.
Allah, 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 Allah. I'm a ridiculous person, and you're lucky you've paid no money to see me.
The first set of recordings have never been leaked online, let alone officially released. According to the Dream Brother biography, this is because both Jeff and Sony felt strongly unhappy about the first set of concerts and decided to record it over again. However, this hasn't stopped fans from seeking out the first set, as no other recordings from Chenier appear to exist aside from the unconfirmed bootlegs. The next batch of allegedly missing tracks stems from the recording of Jeff Buckley's first album, Grace. Jeff had recorded a long list of tracks for Grace, even omitting one track that Sony thought would be his first breakout hit, Forget Her, which was replaced by So Real. Released in 1994, Grace received massive critical acclaim and was a modest commercial success, though not enough of one to please Sony. Grace is my favorite album of all time, and it's because it reaches these emotional depths that you almost never hear coming out of a musician. Later, Sony would release another two-disc legacy edition of Grace, just like they did for Live at Chenier. The second disc featured songs that Buckley and his band had recorded that didn't make it onto the album. These tracks are phenomenal in quality, a rare feat for a recording artist's unreleased scrapped tracks. Also featured on the disc is the track Forget Her, which is haunting and emotional. It's hard to blame Jeff for not wanting to release it. The release pleased fans, and many people thought that this would be the complete list of tracks ever recorded for Grace. We'll get back to that later. Buckley spent the next 2 years touring to promote the album. Sony brought him back in the studio in 1996 to start working on his second album, tentatively titled My Sweetheart the Drunk. The production was rather troubled, even by perfectionist Buckley standards. With producer's seat originally helmed by Tom Verlaine from the band Television, Jeff had high hopes, though the company was skeptical and wanted Buckley to change producers. Shortly before the sessions, Buckley's drummer Matt Johnson bolted out of frustration, leading Buckley to have to rush hire a new drummer. This drummer did not satisfy Verlaine or Buckley, leading to many re-recordings. Ultimately unsatisfied with the results, Buckley was forced to fire Verlaine as producer and seek out a whole different direction on the album. After more frustration between him and the band, Buckley decided he needed a break and spent a few months in Mississippi near the Wolf River. He started recording a few tracks for the album, calling his band and the label, getting them excited. However, on the day that the album was supposed to restart production, Jeff drowned in the Wolf River after taking a swim despite the warnings of the locals about its aggressive currents. Now, take this into consideration. Buckley wasn't suicidal, and he also wasn't a very heavy drug user like his father, although he did use marijuana pretty frequently, which isn't really that big of a deal, and he dabbled in heroin once and experimented with psychedelics here and there, but he wasn't addicted. Buckley died a very un-rockstar-like death, and he was taken from us far too soon. My Sweetheart the Drunk received a posthumous release in 1998 as a two-disc set. The label and the Dream Brother biography both state that it used all the material from the sessions. However, YouTube leakings and alleged bootlegs seem to have proven otherwise. As YouTube took hold in popularity, so did uploads of rare and lost tracks by certain bands and artists. Of these artists, Jeff was included. Descriptions from these recordings state that they were recorded in 1996 or 97 during the Sweetheart the Drunk sessions. Whether these claims are true or not is yet to be proven. One thing is for certain though, the voice and musical style on these recordings are most definitely Buckley's. Other clues that they might come from the same sessions are from a documentary called Amazing Grace covering Buckley's life. In this documentary, it's said that Buckley threw away an entire album's worth of material during the sessions. It's unclear if it's talking about the Tom Verlaine sessions, which were released on the posthumous album, or if it's talking about something else entirely. Another clue comes once again from the Dream Brother biography that stated that Jeff was using effects pedals to make the tracks more atmospheric. Two of these leakings feature Buckley using effects pedals, creating an atmosphere not far removed from shoegazing sounds. Since his death, Sony has released virtually countless different live recordings and demos in order to please fans. It seems to be a challenge in and of itself just to find a recording that doesn't have some sort of likable quality to it. There are a few tracks that remain unreleased, with a formally thought comprehensive list on Buckley's own website. One instrumental track titled Blue Sky Skin has never seen the light of day for unknown reasons. Fans have clamored for its release since Buckley's guitarist, Michael Tye, thought it was one of the best things they ever did. This track, along with Buckley's other slew of unreleased material, remains in either the Sony vaults or the hands of Buckley's mother, Mary Guibert. Speaking of the Sony vaults, a release snuck up on me this year that I didn't know about until a couple of weeks ago, featuring some unreleased tracks by Jeff Buckley. This new album, titled You and I, features demos recorded a year before the release of Grace, and, to some, were considered part of the Grace sessions. According to Steve Berkowitz, a Sony executive, they were recorded to help Buckley break the ice, so to speak. These tracks, while documented in the Dream Brother biography, were little known and were thought to be just an experiment. Record companies almost never save tracks like these. And here they are, being released nearly 20 years after Buckley's death. With Sony releasing these tracks that they've been holding in their vaults for over 20 years, it's hard to tell what else they might have up their sleeve. With Buckley's passing almost at its 20-year mark, I think it's time to start getting these tracks released. Now, I understand that not every single little insignificant recording has to be released, but there still appears to be quite a bit of high-quality material that is yet to see the light of day. Buckley has influenced many indie and mainstream singer-songwriters in the last two decades, including Bono from U2, Jimmy Page from Led Zeppelin, John Mayer, Jason Mraz, and the list goes on. I think the fans deserve the right to hear as many songs as possible by this amazing artist. Now I get to delve into my personal life and talk about my experience with Jeff Buckley. Oh, don't worry. It's just as boring as it sounds, I promise. For me, Jeff Buckley is one of the most important role models of my life. When I was a teenager, I didn't get out much and spent most of my time on the internet. I would frequent sites such as Zenhex, Quizilla, and My Yearbook, mostly looking for girls to talk to that I would later form long-distance relationships with. I don't really consider these relationships legitimate now, but I was a teenager and they carried a lot of weight on me then. After a rather messy breakup with one girl, I found myself obsessing about it. I ended up in a bit of a depressive rut that was hard to get myself out of. One night, after struggling to sleep, I turned on the radio to a local soft rock station that played soothing electronica and alternative rock late at night. One of the songs that played that night was Buckley's rendition of Leonard Cohen's classic Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The song soothed me so much that within minutes I had fallen asleep. Somehow, when I awoke the next day, I remembered the song and started doing research to find out exactly who it was. Eventually and naturally, my research led me to Buckley. Buckley inspired me to start writing more lyrics, and he helped me get my mind off of the girl I was obsessing over. I started buying as many albums and songs by him as possible. Into my adult years, I started dating women in the flesh, and every time it didn't work out, Buckley's music was always there to console me. I suffer from OCD, and since I obsess about things that go wrong in my life, it helps to have a voice there to soothe me. Something about the man's stunning range and emotion helped me heal emotionally. Then, in 2013, I was thrown out of a band called Ocean Void, which I go into more detail about in an episode of Two Beats Plus. For several months, I was uncharacteristically depressed, and got out even less than I ever had before. I pushed away many of my friends with crazy red pill ideology that was eventually scrapped when I realized exactly how many people didn't want to be around me when I thought like that. I was sad, angry, and bitter, emotions that I never really thought I'd actually feel. Then I started getting into the Lost Media Wiki, which led me to writing articles. One night, I found out about the lost and unreleased tracks of Jeff Buckley and heard some of the leaked songs on YouTube. One such song, a guitar version of the track You and I from My Sweetheart the Drunk, struck me and I began to cry. Suddenly, all the bitterness and sadness I bottled up from all those months came out, and I felt horrible for the way I had treated everyone. This was a rejected recording from My Sweetheart the Drunk, and yet its amazing musical quality drove me to actually try to get my life back together. Yes, the sound quality is lacking because it isn't mixed, but that happens when unreleased songs get leaked. It made me want to do something great again. Being in a band was a bit out of the question, but I always admired video reviewers such as Doug Walker and Top in the Shadows and aimed to do a music-related one. This was when I finally brought the idea to my friend Alan. It's incredibly rare for an artist's unreleased track to have this type of effect on people. And it's not just me. There's many people who comment on these videos saying that they're some of Jeff's best moments. That's because a lot of them were recorded while Jeff was in Mississippi, resting after the failed initial sessions for his second album. Jeff was in a very peaceful place, having made a lot of mental healing. He even made amends with his dead father and started to become more comfortable talking about him. These tracks are just rough sketches that Jeff recorded onto 4-track tapes, but a lot of times they feel like fully realized songs. Why they never saw the light of day is beyond me. Now, what I'm about to do is something that I rarely do for the Lost Media Chronicles, but it seems like for once a creator is actually listening, and maybe I should say more like the studio of a creator is listening. This is a rare opportunity. In a recent interview for the release of the new Buckley album, Steve Berkowitz said that the tracks were, quote, never really lost, unquote.
Well, they were never really lost. These were demos that Jeff did, and I was with him, and we recorded in 1993.
In this internet age, how is it that none of this has leaked or been bootlegged?
Well, fortunately, the three or four copies of them that were out there, with Steve Adabo, the original engineer, and myself and Jeff and the Sony vault, they were kept in a safe place, and none of those people abused the tapes that they had, and they stayed silent and quiet until now.
This is a strange instance because the only place I can think of that considers the tracks lost is the Lost Media Wiki, which tells me that he probably read the article and didn't understand that the wiki also catalogs significant media that was just never made publicly available. Here's the thing, I wrote that article. Could I have somehow helped influence Berkowitz to release the tracks? That might be a bit of a hasty moment of unwarranted self-importance on my part, but it's the impression I get. Due to my personal connection with Jeff's music, the fact that Sony seems to be listening, and the 20th anniversary of Jeff's death just around the corner, I have decided to devise a petition. Imagine if we can get a lot of signatures for this thing. This could open up the door to getting a lot of these tracks released. And not only that, it would help other companies start to listen more to fans. Not all of the tracks may be gold, but for a man who has left behind such a deep musical legacy over such a short period of time, a lot of fans just want to hear them. Maybe something will come of this petition, maybe not, but I'll never know if I don't try. And try as I might, it looks like we're out of time for this episode. Join us next time when we talk about something that the Wikia readers will go crazy about. See you later. Hello guys, thank you so much for watching. As you can see, music is one of my most passionate points of interest. If you like what you saw today, feel free to click subscribe and check out other episodes of the Lost Media Chronicles, as well as our music review show, Two Beats Plus, which features my co-host Trey. We're bringing it back in May, so be sure to freshen up on your Season 1 episodes and look forward to Season 2. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Thank you.